There's a sector of America's vast music world that appears to be under the radar. But a music festival that has found a home in Rochester is keeping the work of some groundbreaking and legendary composers and musicians alive. For more than 20 years, the Gateway's Music Festival has shared the music and contributions of classical musicians of African descent. Nearly 100 classically trained musicians from around the country gather in Rochester to perform at venues throughout the city. This year, the Biennial Festival will be celebrating the musical creations of Black women composers whose work was often not recorded or published. I recently sat down with Paul Burgett, University Vice President and Adjunct Professor of Music at the University of Rochester. He'll be paying tribute to 5 selected Black women composers at the Gateway's Music Festival. He shares more about their impact on American culture. Check it out. When most people think about the contributions of African-American musicians in terms of on our society through the ages, what do they typically think of? I mean, whether you're students or adults who love all genres of music, how typically would they respond to that?
When you think about the music of Black Americans, what genre come to mind? What do you think of? And understandably, I will hear jazz and blues and rock and rap and gospel. But it doesn't occur to folks that there may be a world of classical music, music written by musicians of African descent.
Why?
Well, I think classical music struggles in any event to gain audience and gain attention. The music of Black Americans even more so, because of the music in popular culture dominates the landscape. It dominates the landscape, it dominates the airwaves, it dominates, it has enormous economic potential and realization, and classical music far less so. So I think there are economic factors, there are social factors that play into this music being existing in the shadows. And part of the Gateway's Music Festival is to bring it out of the shadows. It's been difficult for women generally to attract the same attention to their compositional artistry and, importantly, to performances. When we think of the 19th century, for example, we think of Clara Schumann, Robert Schumann's wife. But there are not many other women whose names come to mind. So if it's difficult for men in terms of recognition in the classical music domain, it's really difficult for women. This year we're going to feature in our concert in Kodak Hall on Sunday the 16th at 4 o'clock, free and open to the public, we're going to feature the Symphony No. 1 in E minor of Florence Price. What's important about this is that Florence Price arguably is the most well-known Black woman composer, American woman composer, and this symphony is the first by a Black woman to be formed by, to be performed, premiered actually in 1933 by a major American orchestra, the Chicago Symphony. In 1931, it won the Wanamaker Award, which was a prize set up by the Wanamaker family for gifted African-American composers. She won it for other pieces as well.
I've read that the Symphony No. 1 in E minor had a profound cultural influence on American society at the time. How will you be discussing the cultural significance of that work in particular?
Yeah, that's a very good question. That symphony actually, in my mind, sort of sits in a place with 2 other symphonies that had a dramatic effect on the perception of the nation, to the extent that there were people in the country paying attention to this, about African-American composers of symphonies. William Grant Still, referred to as the Dean of Afro-American Composers, and his Afro-American Symphony of 1931, which coincidentally received its premiere in Rochester, New York, at the Eastman School of Music, with the Rochester Philharmonic, Howard Hanson conducting in 1931. That symphony, William Levy Dawson's Negro Folk Symphony in the same decade, and then Florence Price's Symphony No. 1. Those 3 symphonies provided a kind of apotheosis or ultimate context of the realization of the dream of the talented 10th, if you will, to cite W.E.B. Du Bois, the realization of a dream that African Americans, musicians of African descent, had arrived in the environment of the music of literate Western cultural traditions. Not popular music, but as we conventionally refer to it, classical music. Margaret Bonds was a very close associate of Florence Price. In fact, she was a student of Florence Price's. She found her way to composition, and she, like all of the women that I'm going to be talking about, their output, their literature was huge. I mean, they composed, you know, upwards of 100 works, you know, many of which they never got to hear, most of which were never recorded, and many of which were not even published.
What's the reason for that, the not recorded, not published?
It was of little interest and little economic return. The recording industry is interested in what's going to provide a return on investment. And because this was music by people who were largely unknown, there was not a market in the view of the producers of this music. And so, and then I think that the bogeyman of race was always there. So race loomed wherever you looked, but that never stopped any of our heroines, you know? So Margaret Bonds, I've chosen her piece, Troubled Waters, which is actually based on a Negro spiritual, Wade in the Water. Now, Wade in the Water is really well known. It's a well-known piece. Undine Smith Moore. Now, Undine Smith Moore was important in a way that exceeds even some of the others, particularly as a teacher. She spent 45 years on the faculty at Virginia State College. She produced musical artists like Billy Taylor, for example, who went out into the world, and of course he's no longer with us, but he was very famous as a jazz pianist and educator.
You've called her a musical titan in the world of teaching, composition, and performance
exactly.
in the Black community.
No, that's exactly right. She's no longer with us, but her protégés are out and about all over the United States. Before I Be a Slave is a spiritual that's familiar to many, many people. And then I will play her piece, her interpretation of that spiritual. There is no reference to the spiritual in this piece at all. The piece is harsh, it's cruel, it's violent, it is clashes of chords, it's atonal, that means it's without a tonal center. And then it goes into a kind of elegiac second half of the piece. So it really gets your attention, you know, and it reflects her feelings about Before I'd Be a Slave. These are my feelings about that.
What do you want people to really grasp, understand, or appreciate about their work that their work that they likely didn't know about before?
Number one, what I hope people will come away with is we heard some great music that was well performed. That matters. That it is good music that is performed at the highest levels. That's what we aspire to at Gateways. Number two, oh my God. This segment of the American population, who we had no idea were this good, African Americans, Americans of African descent, provided us with this. What have we been missing? And ought we not to be hearing more of it? That's what we want to come out of this week of music making.
The Gateways Music Festival runs from August 11th to the 16th. All concerts are free and open to the public. You can check out Paul Burgett's community conversation forum, Black Women Composers, on Saturday, August 15th at Hochstein School of Music and Dance at 5:30, just before the 7 o'clock chamber music concert. To learn more about the Gateways Music Festival and concert times and locations, go to gatewaysmusicfestival.org.